My name is Graham Sexton, and I'd like to welcome you to my short presentation on packet injection for 802.11 using AirPcap NX. So, first of all, let's just talk about what packet injection is. The idea is really simple. It's just the ability to insert custom packets or pre-assigned packets or recorded packets into a wireless network in the way that you'd want to test the network in some particular way. There are a number of ways that you can do this. You can replay individual packets or multiple packets that you might have actually captured from a network. You can edit up single packets and customize those packets to do pretty much whatever you want. There's a tool that Riverbed actually provide for this, and it's called AirPcap Replay. And that's the primary tool for the packet injection that we use, at least here. There are other tools available, but it's very much integrated into the AirPcap NX capture card. So the AirPcap Replay tool, there are two screens to look at. The first one that we're looking at here is where we might be interested in transmitting an individual packet. And the screen's broken down into a number of areas. Of course, the more detail can be found on the Riverbed website itself. The screen is broken down into a number of areas, and I'm just going to point to those areas. First of all, the area that I'm pointing at right now is essentially the hex editor area, and you're free to edit each of these bytes within the screen and change those bytes to whatever you want. As long as it's a valid packet, it'll be absolutely fine. So we can see at the left hand side of the screen the addresses of the data itself, and we can see at the right hand side of the screen the ASCII representation of that particular data. And of course the data in hex in between is the actual data that we're going to transmit. We are free to load a packet in that we might have saved using maybe Wireshark. We can save the packet. We can reset the packet to its initial values, and we can clear the packet entirely if we want to do that. So looking at the rest of the screen, we can see that we've got an area down here which allows us to specify the adapter that we might have connected. In my case, I only have one adapter, and that's the AirPcap adapter. But nonetheless, that gives us flexibility if there are multiple adapters there. I can change my transmission mode. I can transmit at the maximum possible frequency. That is the maximum number of packets I can send in any one time. Or I can specify the actual packet period by specifying an appropriate number in here. I can set the channel that I'm going to inject the data onto. That's very important not to forget that. It's very easy to transmit on the wrong channel and be wondering where your data actually is, and it's only because you've transmitted on the wrong channel. We've got the opportunity to transmit at different transmission rates, 802.11 transmission rates as well. We can control the number of times the individual packet is actually transmitted. So it's just set to 10. So the packet that's in the window will be transmitted 10 times. Or we can set this number to 0 and it'll transmit forever until we stop it transmitting. So to make it transmit, you just press the transmit button. And once it's transmitting, then what you will see is a green, usually green, bar progressing along the transmit line. If you're in the infinite mode, transmit forever, it will transmit forever until you press the stop key itself. So that's pretty much what we have for the packet transmit, and we'll see an example of us using the packet transmit later on in the slide set. Another way of transmitting data is to transmit a file. So you might have captured a file using Wireshark, and you might want to transmit the whole file. So you might have, in essence, a collection of packets in there rather than just one or two, perhaps. So you can replay whatever those conditions are. So you have to have generated that file in the first place using Wireshark or TCP dump. And then load that file in so the system has access to it, and it will then transmit it on the same sort of basis that we described just before. So let's take an example of take a look at an example of how we might apply some of those ideas in the case of deauthenticating a station. So you might remember that when a station connects to an access point, it goes through an authentication and authorization phase so that it can actually transmit data between the station and the access point, and vice versa, of course. And in doing so, there are authentication packets passed between the station and the access point. And what we're free to do, of course, with most implementations of 802.11 is to actually observe those authentication packets. So what we're going to do is to observe a system that is authenticating and capture one of those authentication packets, and then capture a deauthentication packet as well. So what are the basic steps to actually do a real deauthenticate? So we need a deauthenticate packet to begin with. And the easy way to do it is to actually capture one, a real one, rather than make it from scratch. But you can make it from scratch as well. We then need to insert the packet in AirCapture Replay and transmit the deauthentication packet. And then we can observe the station being disconnected. So how would we generate a deauthentication packet? Well, it turns out if you actually have a system, a station and an access point that are connected already, if you disable the wireless interface in a controlled manner, then the station will quite naturally generate a deauthentication packet. It's its proper behavior. So we can take advantage of that and capture that deauthentication packet for later use. Let's take a look at how we can capture a deauth packet. So what I already have set up is another PC, not the one that I'm hosting Wireshark on, but another PC that's connected to an access point. I've already checked the channel that that PC and access point are operating on, and they're operating on channel 4, and I've got channel 4, as you see, already selected on the screen here. Just to help me find the packet that I'm looking for, I've inserted a display filter, and this display filter will allow me to look at deauth packets. So it's wlan.fc.type/subtype is equal to 12, and that will show the deauth packets. Now what you can see on the screen already is an existing a capture that I've done before, just to make sure that this whole thing works. But I'm going to do this again. So what I'll do, I'll set the capture in motion. I'll set that going right now. And as soon as I've set that going, I'm going to go and disable the wireless interface on the PC that's connected to the access point that we're looking at. And what will happen is, or what should happen, is the PC will throw out a deauth packet. So let's start the capture. There, this is the capture started, and I'm now going to disable the interface, and you can see that the deauth packet has been generated immediately. I'm going to stop the capture there, and I'm just going to modify the window so you can see more of that. And you can see, let's just select the packet that I actually want. There we are. Oops, sorry about that. There's the packet that we want. And see if I can just bring that into the screen. Yeah, that'll do. Okay, so what we have is the deauth packet. And a couple of things just to be careful with. You probably know this already. But if we look at the packet itself, let's just select the deauth packet. What you can see in the window just below here that I'm pointing at now are the bytes that are really part of the deauth packet that are being sent. What can be a little bit distracting is the information that relates to the radio tap header, and it's very easy to get confused without looking very carefully and thinking that these first collection of bytes that I'm pointing to here are all part of the packet that's actually transmitted. That's not the case, and you just need to remember that. So when we export the actual 82.11 packet, you're not going to see those first collection of bytes. The other bytes that are not highlighted at the end are part of the packet that's transmitted. It's just not highlighted because we've got some fixed parameters there, and there's the frame checksum, which are the last four bytes. They're all transmitted. So what we've got to do is make some use of this particular packet. And what I'm going to try and do is export that packet. I'll show you how to export that packet for later usage. So I need to make sure that I've got the correct packet selected. And it's not very helpful because we've got these two packets, and the lower packet is marked with a black colouring, which is slightly unhelpful. But I've selected the deauth packet. I then need to go to File and Export Specific Packets, click on that. I'll then make sure I select or export the selected packets only, so that's just one packet. I'm going to give it a name. I also need to make sure that the file type is appropriate, and the AirCap replay module unfortunately isn't able to read in at the moment anyway the PCAP NG file format. It's a more modern file format. It's only able to read the old PCAP file format, so we just need to make sure that we've got the PCAP file format selected. I'm just going to give the packet a new name. I'm going to call it deauth packets, deauth 6, and that's about it. Now the save button is just off the screen. Let's just bring that in. So there's the save button. So click on the save button, and hey presto, I've now got that packet saved. So we're in a position now where we have a genuine deauth packet that's available to us that we can now replay to our heart's content. Let's go to the next phase of generating our deauthentication. So we're going to use the AirPcap replay module to inject a packet across the network. You can see the interface running there, where we've got the packet transmit tab selected. So I'm planning to load that packet that I've just saved, which was one of the deauth packets, and I think it was deauth 6, so we'll just select that and load that in. So there we have our deauth packet loaded in. There are just a few things that we need to make sure are set up correctly to make sure this actually works. So we need to ensure that we have the correct interface. I've only got one adapter on this machine, so we don't have much choice there. We need to make sure that we're going to inject onto the right channel, and I'm just using channel 4 once again. That's the same channel that I actually captured the deauth from. We need to say something about how we're going to throw the packets out of the interface. So there are a number of ways. We can select either maximum possible frequency, so the if packets are thrown out as fast as the interface can, or we can select a period. Now I've just selected somewhat arbitrarily, partially to not to stop overloading the network, to send a packet out every 50 milliseconds, and I'm setting my limit to the maximum number of 1,000 packets. If you want to keep transmitting forever, you can actually select zero and it'll just keep going forever. They're about the only things that we need to worry about to actually make this happen. So I'll press the transmit button, and I have to say it's a not very spectacular picture that you're going to see here. You're not going to see confirmation of anything, so I'll just stop at this point. But on another screen, which I'll show you on the next slide, I can't show you on the same slide, we can actually see the impact of the deauth packet on the other machine. So we can see that we have an attack currently going on the network, and I'm hoping that we'll be able to see something happen. It doesn't happen instantly. It takes a little while for just the systems to report what is actually happening, but the attack is currently underway. There we go. So we can see that the connection's broken, and no internet access. Now what the PC should do, it should sort itself out and realize that I can't connect to the particular access point I've got it connected to, and it'll find another access point. I've got the PC already aware of half a dozen other access points. So we can see that the deauth actually worked in this particular case. Now, creating your own packet rather than relying on a captured packet gives you the maximum flexibility, but it's not trivial. Hand creation and hand crafting of packets is pretty hard work indeed. You need to observe the framing rules with absolute precision. You can't make a single mistake in a single byte, otherwise it basically won't work properly. Nonetheless, it's sometimes a good exercise to actually do this. But sometimes there are halfway houses where you might, for example, do a deauth packet, but you might want to change the address. Now, changing the addresses is pretty easy, but what you have to do is to just make sure that you calculate the checksum correctly as well. And that's probably what the trickiest part. To do this manually with a pen and a piece of paper would take you forever, but fortunately there are tools around, and there's a tool at this website, www.lamabees.nl, that does checksum calculations, and it's the 32-bit checksum calculation. So you just need to take in effect all of the data from the 802.11 frame and pop that into the online calculator, and it will give you the checksum. You might just note though that my observation is that the checksum that the Lamabees website produces, it seems to have the bytes out of order, so it's little endian as opposed to big endian, so you just need to make sure that you get the byte order correctly. But nonetheless, you can create your own packets and merrily do whatever you want with the system. So just to summarize what we've looked at today, we've looked at an outline of using our AirPcap NX USB card to capture and replay packets, and how the AirPcap replay tool is used to replay those packets and help us to generate and inject packets. And specifically, we've looked at capturing and replaying a deauthentication packet. I hope this has been useful to you, and thank you very much for watching.